will get the best players. The Suns receive potential talent and a lot of salary cap space. Marbury, an all-star talent, averaging 21 points, 8 rebounds a game, immediately makes the Knicks better and perhaps more important, makes them matter. Wanting to get home and join his fourth team in 8 seasons, does that. Penny Hardaway also moves to the Garden, still going to fill the sixth man role, can play 3 different spots, and on certain days can still be the best player in the gymnasium. Antonio McDice. He spent the 97-98 season dunking Jason Kidd passes in Phoenix, just returned to the Knicks lineup for more than a year, sidelined with a knee injury, but Kurt Thomas moved him out of the starting job, so he was expendable. His contract done at the end of the year. Likewise, Charlie Ward's deal will expire at the end of the season. Ward might now be the best quarterback in Phoenix as he was in New York. His 10 years in the city made him the last of the Pat Riley Knicks on the roster. Now to
we want to win, and not only do we want to win, the challenge has been issued to be the best. Our players, our organization, we strive to be the best. You just don't have the opportunity to go out and get players such as himself. There are very few players in the league like him.
All right, we recap and round out the big deal. Marbury, Hardaway, and their 2 max contracts, and Cesare Trubinsky.
Who?
To New York. Trubinsky.
Just want you to see it again.
You see it spelled there. Phoenix gets McDice, Ward, Howard, Isley, Magic Lampe, the rights to another point guard currently playing in Europe, and two number one picks. Zeke's turned over half the Knicks roster in just 2 weeks on the job. Greg Anthony, your point of view, please.
The New York Knicks once again have become relevant in the Eastern Conference with the acquisition of Stephon Marbury and Penny Hardaway. You now see an overall talent upgrade for this basketball team. And more importantly, you're now going to see Keith Van Horn move over to the third slot in terms of the scoring options, allowing Stephon Marbury and Allen Houston to be the more dominant factors offensively. Kurt Thomas now will be implemented into that power forward role, along with Dikembe Mutombo anchoring the center position. That should make this basketball team a legitimate contender in the Atlantic Division and arguably give them the best backcourt in the Eastern Conference.
A review as to why Marbury makes your team better. Only 2 guys have averaged at least 20 points and 8 assists a game in their NBA careers. The Big O and Marbury. Robertson averaged both 20 and 8 in 10 different seasons, played 14, while Marbury has done it 5 times in his career, including at the moment.
Close.
Yeah. What do you think it is? It's not official, but it's getting there. That close. Maybe that close. Tom Coughlin and the New York Football Giants dotting the I's and crossing the T's on a contract that will make him Big Blue's next head coach. Coughlin has long been a favorite of the Merritt family. He does have history here. Do you remember Wide Right? January 1991, Scott Norwood's missed field goal that gave the Giants their 2nd Super Bowl title under head coach Bill Parcells. Well, Tom Coughlin was a receivers coach for that team. And a couple years later, he turned down a chance to take over as head coach of the Giants because he was still rebuilding the Boston College program. By the time he was ready to go, the Giants had gone another way, and Coughlin ended up as head coach of the expansion Jacksonville Jaguars. And he built a winner there with his strong disciplinarian ways. Posted a 72-64 record over 8 seasons, making 2 trips to the AFC Championship game. But if you live by this sort of discipline, you must be prepared to die by it as well. And his team would not respond in his final 3 years. He was fired after posting 3 losing seasons there. After sitting out this season, Coughlin is ready to come back, and if all goes well with the Giants, Coughlin is expected to sign a 4-year deal worth more than $11 million to become their new head coach. Well, the
dynamic and dreams. In 1995, the legend was fulfilled. Marbury and Lincoln High School had won the PSAL championship. Stephon spent 1 season attending Georgia Tech, then the dream part 2 came true. Marbury was drafted 4th overall by Milwaukee, then traded to Minnesota for Ray Allen. The T-Wolves were young, dynamic, and determined, but Stephon couldn't play Robin to Kevin Garnett's Batman and wanted out of Minneapolis in favor of Gotham City.
What I meant by saying that I pray for this day to come is for me to come back home. I'm a New Jerseyan now instead of a New Yorker.
The love affair was mutual as Marbury proved clutch and flourished for the Nets. The comeback came full circle when Marbury returned to Minnesota. Stephon celebrated his birthday in style, blowing out 39 points and having a party.
Here comes Lucius Harris. Stephon Marbury taking it to the rim.
Could not have asked for more from Stephon Marbury.
Garnett. Garnett with the shot. Not a good one, but tip missed by Seeley. Rebounded by Kiddles as time works out. A very happy return for Stephon Marbury.
Stephon seemed content. Marbury was the man and he enjoyed the bright lights. The All-Star team beckoned and the future looked bright. Final seconds. Marbury, mid-court, launching. It's there! It's gone!
Up by 21.
Oh! Oh! Get away!
You've got to be kidding me!
What was that?
Back pocket 8. Low penetration. Knocked away. The Nets have it. 30 seconds to play. Marbury for the tie.
Oh! Get out of town!
Step on
Marbury!
He is unconscious.
But the injuries took their toll. The losing took their spirit. The frustration continued to build. The chemistry came into question, and the foundation began to falter. Did Marbury get along with Keith Van Horn? Did someone have to go? The Coney Island kid was shipped to the desert. Stephon barely said hello. Now the Nets said so long.
To Jason, just say good luck. I said good luck with a smile.
So again, the one knock on Marbury, he's been traded four times.
That's it. The Tom Coughlin era is underway. The free ride is over. Head coach number 16 in the storied franchise that is the New York Giants. A history that took a hit this past season when the Giants posted their worst record in nearly two decades. 11 years ago, Coughlin was Bill Parcells' receivers coach here. Today, he's got the big job after signing a four-year, $12 million contract, and he has his work cut out for him following an underachieving season past. Where the Giants finished 4-up and 12-down and sent Jim Fossil packing. Today, Coughlin began his rejuvenation plan for Big Blue.
What we must be all about right now, immediately, is the restoration of pride, of self-pride, of team pride, the restoration of our professionalism and the dignity with which we conduct our business. We must restore our belief in the process by which we will win, and we must replace despair with hope and return the energy and the passion to New York Giant football.
So just how do you do that? Well, you might expect Coughlin does have a plan. It begins with eliminating mistakes and mental errors, two problems that plagued Big Blue all season long.
We must eliminate turnovers. You're not going to beat anybody being minus 16. That stat has got to radically change. We must eliminate costly penalties. You can't shoot yourself in the foot and expect to win the 100-meter dash.
But you know what? Coughlin's race just got tougher on day one.
Is the man. He comes to the Knicks with more wins in NBA history. A one-time Coach of the Year in 1994. Also an NBA championship in 1979 with the Seattle Supersonics. A gold medal winning coach in the 1996 Olympics in Atlanta, Georgia. Lenny Wilkins is now 66 years old. So a challenge for the one-night head coach of the New York Knicks, Herb Williams. For more, let's go.
The all-time winningest Knicks coach as far as winning percentage goes.
Percentage will be 1,000. Yeah, for the second time in his three-week regime, Isaiah Thomas was in a New York state of mind. Radically changes the face of the team. First, it was Stephon Marbury. Now Lenny Wilkins will be the next head coach of the Knicks. We'll have complete coverage of Chaney out, Wilkins in. After we chronicle the way the day ended at the Garden, it was actually a game played, and it was a game in which the Knicks made their point, Kurt. Actually, they made a lot of points.
Yeah, about an hour and 45 minutes before the game, the Knicks announced that Don Chaney would be out. So Herb Williams was on the sideline for one game only as interim head coach for the night. And maybe because of the coaching change or this is the way they'll play now, the Knicks came out humming against Orlando. Allen Houston, after the good ball movement, hits the three, and the Knicks took a two-point lead. They got down by one. Houston backing down Keith Bogans, the pretty turnaround. Houston with 13 in the first half, 23 in the game, and the Knicks just look rejuvenated all night long. Watch the passing here. Finishes up with Keith Van Horn on the reverse. Knicks had a six-point edge. More great passing. Marbury penetrates, then dumps down to Thomas for the layup. One of 10 assists for Stephon, and the Knicks were up 8. Magic cut it to 56-52. Marbury, though, all the way, and the foul. Knicks up 64-57 at half. Those 64 points, most in the first half, all season long. Yeah, everybody's celebrating. Third quarter, a different story, though. Orlando went on a 20-10 run. McGrady, part of his 28-point night, put him up 79-72. But the Knicks come back. Marbury to the baseline. His shot is short, but there's Michael Doliak to tip in. And the Knicks were back up 88-86. Knicks started to run again off the miss. Marbury racing up court to Keith Van Horn. Van Horn hits the three. He finished with 22. And the Knicks were up 101-95. 2.5 left to play. Marbury says, hey, I can do that too. Drains the three, part of his 26-point night to go with those 10 assists. And the Knicks get a big win in Herb Williams' coaching debut, 120-110.
So the Knicks scored 121 on Monday against Dallas. They come back with 120 on Wednesday. 60% shooting from the field for New York. In fact, the Knicks were 9 of 13 from three-point range. It's the seventh time this year the Knicks have scored more than 100. It's the fifth time this year they've won a game by double digits. Stephon Marbury is 26-10, plenty enough as the Knicks under Herb Williams for one night, 120-110, the final.
Well, the beginning of this strange day for the organization actually started right about 5:45. That's when Isaiah Thomas told the world that everyone had expected it for quite some time was coming true. Don Chaney would no longer be the head coach. The surprise, though, came in the name of the man who would replace him.
Making a change like this is never easy, and I know from personal experience how difficult it is to be on the receiving end. I'm not going to get into specifics about why this decision was made, other than to say I felt change is necessary. Don Chaney is a good man, and he gave the Knicks his best. Tomorrow we will be introducing the new Knicks head coach, and that is Lenny Wilkins. After meeting with Steve and Jim, and after evaluating our team and our coaching staff, at the present time, it just seemed that it was the right time to make a change. You never thought you would be able to get a Hall of Fame coach to come and coach your team. Having the opportunity to have the winningest coach in basketball, we pride ourselves and we want to be the best. And having an opportunity to go out and select the best, I just thought it was a perfect fit, and I think he's a perfect fit for Stephon. And at the end of the day, I just thought Lenny would be a better fit for our team.
So, again, sticking with that New York...
Guess this one. The winds of change blew in a new head coach for the New York Knicks. This story started 25 days ago with the hiring of new team president Isaiah Thomas. Since then, a blockbuster trade. A head coach fired, and today, a head coach hired. The Lenny Wilkins era has begun.
I am excited to be the new Knicks coach.
He is both an NBA Hall of Fame player and coach. Lenny Wilkins has garnered more wins and losses than any other coach in league history. And now the pride of Brooklyn is coming home to coach the hometown Knickerbockers.
To have an opportunity to come back and accept the challenge of working with the Knicks was just overwhelming.
Wilkins is known as a player's coach, preferring to guide his troops with a calm, professional touch rather than berating them.
I'm not a yeller, I'm not a screamer, I'm demanding. Okay? And I don't make a whole lot of expressions.
Midway through today's news conference, the Knicks' other new addition, Stephon Marbury, made an appearance to welcome his new head coach. Now, the work begins.
We got our work cut out for us. But I'm an optimist.
All right, after today's meeting with the media, immediately, right to work for the Wilkins and the Knicks. Here's the players' take on the new head coach.
He made it clear that he's not going to change things so much that it confuses us or disrupts us, but I think he may tweak some things, and I think he just wants to come in and help us improve.
I can't put any stipulations on it, but I know that it's going to take time. I mean, nothing is going to happen overnight.
The Knicks will play their first game under Lenny Wilkins tomorrow night against the Sonics. We move on to Jets news. Today, Gangrene gave head coach
of the New York Knicks. It's been a whirlwind for this team ever since Isaiah Thomas took over as team president. Maybe now that Don Chaney is officially out and the players know that Wilkins is here for the duration, they will be able to concentrate solely on basketball and not have to answer questions day in and day out about the future of Chaney. Wilkins only had one full practice with this team. That was yesterday up in Westchester after his press conference. Tonight on the sidelines as he watched his new team take on Seattle, it was pretty much coaching on the fly 101 until he can get a few more practices with these guys under his belt. Wilkins said before the game he was feeling nervous, living in Seattle before taking this Knicks job, so his family back there able to watch this game tonight on the Seattle Sonics broadcast. Wilkins with the clipboard back in his hands, he's brought in longtime assistant Dick Helm to help him, and Mark Aguirre also on the staff as per Isaiah's request. Herb Williams and Mike Malone also on the staff. First quarter, Ray Allen hits. He wasn't playing when Seattle beat the Knicks back on December 3rd. It was a big night for Keith Van Horn. Early on, goes baseline for the big slam. Thanks Kurt Thomas for the pass. Later in the first quarter, Van Horn pulls up from behind the line, buries the triple, 27-22 Knicks. Then it was time for Penny Hardaway to enter the NBA record books. The pass from Stephon, Hardaway the runner, that gave him 10,000 career points in his NBA career. 10,000 points for Penny. First quarter, all Knicks off the miss. Marbury up court across from Houston. The three is good. Lenny Wilkins loving it. 34-26 Knicks after one. Second quarter, Marbury with the steal, and he's off for the uncontested two-hand slam. Knicks up by 12. Seattle learning the hard way tonight that you cannot leave Keith Van Horn wide open. He'll kill you. First from the corner, and then in the waning seconds of the first half, Van Horn again from Marbury behind the line. He finished with 19 and a half. Knicks led by 18 at the break.
Coach Wilkins, Isaiah, and the new Knicks, come out. New York, I need you to stand on your feet and celebrate with me. Come on.
All right, they were boogieing at the half. It's a celebration. Thought for sure the Knicks would get blown out to put a damper on the great halftime show, but I was wrong. Marbury with the layup, and then it's Dikembe with the rebound out to Marbury. The gorgeous pass, threading the needle to Thomas. The Knicks, instead of getting blown out, blowing it open. 75-46 in the third, off the turnover. Allen Houston will feed Marbury. He pulls up, but instead of shooting, dishes it down low to Van Horn. The reverse slam and the foul. Lenny likes it. Van Horn likes it. He led all scorers tonight with 30. How bad was it for the Sonics? Flip Murray blows the slam late third quarter. Another look at it. Wasn't any prettier on the slow-mo. Then the chance came down from the seats. Sounded a lot better than fire chant.
New chant, and certainly a more pleasant chant to the Knicks and the Knicks front office.
Knicks win big, 108-88, as Isaiah looked on, listening to the chants coming down from the rafters of Lenny Wilkins. Happy night at the Garden for the fans, for Wilkins, for this Knicks team. An impressive victory over the Sonics, who came into this game with a 19-17 record. That's pretty good out in the Western Conference this year. But Seattle, no match for the Knicks tonight. Van Horn, again, as I said earlier, led the way with 30. Marbury finishes with just 8 points, but he dished out 17 assists. That's what matters from your point guard. Allen Houston with 18. Dikembe with a double-double, 10 points, 12 rebounds. Knicks impressive in Lenny Wilkins' first game, and afterwards, the new head coach couldn't have been more pleased.
Did you even hear them chanting your name tonight?
I knew they were young, so I wasn't really, you know, the first game, you got to be, I'm so focused in trying to get guys to continue to play the good defense they were playing, so I wasn't sure what they were saying.
Lenny, it seemed like everybody was pitching in to get you a win here in your first day coaching at the Garden. How did it feel to come away with that 20-point win, and how was your first day coaching out there?
You know, it was great. I talked with the team about the kind of defense that we have to play, what we want to do, and guys forgot. You know, I called a timeout, we talked about it, reminded them. And the thing that I keep reminding them is that, you know, defense starts everything. And you can have some fun playing defense because it'll give us some easy opportunities. And so, you know, for most of the game, our defense was real good. In the end, it kind of slacked a little bit. But we talked about that after the game. We were better with the turnovers, and then we got a little sloppy there. And so we still have work to do. But I was very pleased with the attitude of how focused they came out to play. And that's a part of, if you want to win, you got to be totally focused.
Lenny, before the game, you sat here and said that Stephon Marbury sometimes overpasses and he needs to be more selfish. He had 17 assists tonight and only took 6 shots. What do you think of his performance?
Great. You know, one of the things you have to understand also, especially when you're the point guard and everything, if the plays are there and you can make it, you got to do it. See? Then what happens is that they start to tighten up on those people. They can't help out on you. So he showed everyone that he could make the play. We bobbled. He should have had 20, 23. But we bobbled a few. And I just would encourage him and tell him, hey, they're going to get used to you. They're going to get used to you. You keep, I mean, guys open, hit him right in the hands. You know, he'll get used to it and he'll grab onto it. But I thought he had a fabulous game. You know, he did everything I asked him to do. You know, and I'm not worried about his scoring because I know he can score.
Coach, how difficult was it to coach a team you only had one practice with prior to
tonight? Well, I was a little nervous, you know, in the beginning. But, we walked through situations. We talked about it. We walked through it again today. And again, we broke some stuff down on video and kept reminding them that this is how we have to do it if you want to be successful. And so they were terrific. You know, give them the credit. They went out there and they did it. And each guy, and you know, Kurt Thomas had a great game. He only scored, 6 points? But he had 8 points. He had a hell of a game. And those are the things that happen that become contagious. Because what it does, it gets your other guys easy opportunities. And the more easy opportunities we get, the better we are.
Coach, I know you only have a few practices, walkthroughs and what have you. And you said that he wasn't going to change the offense as much, but how was you able to have a feel for rotation the way you did?
Well, I mean, I know the personnel, you know, and it's a gut thing about rotations, you know. I know that I had Penny to bring off the bench, you know. I mean, I know that I had Othello Harrington. I know I had Michael Doliak. I've seen Michael play a number of times, played against him. So I know those guys a little bit. And what I try to do is put them in areas where they can be effective. You know, during timeouts, yeah, a couple of times I put in a couple little wrinkles out of timeout that wasn't what they had done before. But just when you're playing well, you can do that. And they executed it perfectly.
Coach, what sort of message does a win like this send out to your rivals?
That when you come into the Garden, you better bring your best basketball.
Coach? Walking out into the court tonight, was it what you had envisioned? What did you feel like?
Well, I didn't know what to expect. The thing is that I thought the fans would be pumped and behind the team and ready for a win. And, we played, I wasn't here, we played this team in Seattle. And we covered them, the coaches, we walked through everything. I mean, everybody knew what we wanted to do. So, we got off to a good start, and I thought the fans were great. I mean, I don't really distinguish noises. I know they were yelling for us, and I try and focus so much on the game that way you never get distracted.
Thanks, Coach. How important is it for a win like this to help you and the team develop confidence and trust in
them? It shows them that they can do it, and that if we trust one another, then we'll have a lot of success.
Give Lenny Wilkins some credit. I'm sure that he heard the chants, and he's taken the high road on that and saying...
Hoisted up to the rafters at Madison Square Garden, Richter joins Rod Gilbert, Eddie Jockman in the exalted list of New York Rangers. Ranger goalie, one more games than number 35. How good was Richter? He made his Ranger debut in the playoffs and continued as the team's cornerstone for nearly 15 years. Bud Mishkin has followed Mike Richter's career from day one and was front row for Mike Richter night at the Garden.
A successful athletic career is built on thousands of days and nights of hard work. And then for a select few, the Hollywood ending, the retiring of one's number. And so it was for Mike Richter Wednesday night at the Garden.
It was overwhelming. I mean, that was just so beautifully done. And what a night. I've got my family and friends and so many people that were part of my life growing up.
The ceremony was vintage Mike Richter, a window into the player and person that teammates, fans, and the media saw for 14 seasons. a sense of who he is, a sense of the game and its history, a sense of the city, and a pretty sharp sense of humor, too.
Right about now, I'm wondering whose idea it was to get a guy who has retired from head injuries to memorize a speech in front of 18,000 after that.
I don't want to go out there and just wing it because it's just too important to not touch on, you know, how much gratitude you have. But, you know, I just looked and I'm just going, I mean, where do you begin to thank?
Richter is only the third Ranger to have his hockey sweater hoisted to the rafters, joining Rod Gilbert and Ed Jockeman.
It's so hard to express because you want to say you're so jubilant and everything, but the thing about it is that there's a certain chill that's going through your body and goosebumps. And
it made my adjustment a little bit easier. It was tough because I didn't feel I was ready to retire yet, and I wanted to play some more, and I'm sure Mike did.
This night may have seemed dreamlike. The end of Richter's career was anything but. He retired because of symptoms stemming from two head injuries suffered in his final two seasons. But Richter will be remembered for so many acrobatic saves. And he will be remembered for the Ranger fans' favorite spring, 1994, when Richter led the Rangers first past the Devils in a titanic Eastern Conference Finals, and then past Pavel Bure and the Vancouver Canucks to win the Stanley Cup and end the 54-year curse.
You know, this is something that, you know, it will never change. This year, our name is engraved in that cup. And, boy, that's you become part of that history.
As good as Mike Richter was on the ice, he was just as good off it. A stand-up, thoughtful guy to the media and the fans. A guy who lived in the city and made the most of the experience, taking classes at Columbia, preparing himself for life beyond the arena.
Everybody who doesn't live in New York has an opinion about New York. It's probably not that favorable, and I was scared coming here, and, you know, these fans that end up being what I consider just friends. It's my home. It's, you know, they're your family.
These are not the best of times for the Rangers. Their fans are restless, and that is putting it mildly. But at least for one night, they could stand and cheer and show their appreciation for one of their favorites. Some happy memories at a not-so-happy time. At the Garden, Bud Mishkin, New York 1.
And through the wonder of television, we'll bring catcher. It wasn't off the bat of Barry Bonds, the San Francisco slugger. Sat out his second straight game in New York with a sinus infection. Mike Piazza was center stage in his first at-bat. Piazza clubbed his 352nd home run as a catcher. The count, 3-1, when the pitcher, David Riske, served up the record breaker to Mike Piazza.
Right center field, hit well, and there's the record.